So, well, most of these notes are not that bad. We can probably trim and do this and that, and it shouldn't be a big deal. We got to the end of the film, and there the Legion of DCC demanded that we scrap the ending and come up with a brand new ending in which we basically said this whole picture was wrong, or the whole concept of doing these surveys was wrong. And I felt that that's going to vitiate the whole, you know, point of the film, and eventually opened my mouth and made a suggestion which Jack Warner liked, and one thing led to another, and suddenly I was writing this new scene, and a man by the name of Les Martinson was hired to direct this scene, and I ostensibly produced this added scene, and Jack Warner made me a producer. And the reason that Henry Danielle figures into this is that I remembered a sequence that had been shot that we had taken out of the film, where Henry Danielle and Ephraim Zimbalist Jr., who was one of the investigators with the Chapman report, met in a scene where Henry Danielle, who had objected to their whole process throughout the film, again reiterated his objections, and they walked out of the shot, and it was a nice big shot with a lot of people in it, into what I suggested be a short little scene that we would write and create, where Zimbalist would sort of defend it again and present his reasons for defending it. As I say, Warner liked it, we did it, and Les directed it, and we added that to the film, and I became a producer. And basically because I think Jack Warner liked the idea that he didn't have to build a big set, that all he had to do was hire one actor back and put him in a very small set, and we could do this in half a day, which is really what we did.
And Henry had quite a life as an actor after, because he was with the Batman movie.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And actually, he was one of George Cukor's favorites.
Yeah.
He actually, later, about a year later, in 63, was in My Fair Lady.
Yeah. The other part I thought interesting, too, that you did, Michael, so many of these English actors had to go back with World War II, back to Britain, and wanted to, they had to fight, they were part of the defending of London,
mm-hmm.
and coming back afterwards to reactivate a career.
Yeah, I guess David Niven's the best example of that. But most of the actors that I speak about in the book were of an age where most of them had done their service during World War I, and had all of them, some had been, George Zucker had been badly wounded, Henry Danielle was also very seriously wounded in the war. And I guess the thing that I liked about all of these, there was a very large British colony in Hollywood in the late 30s and 40s, and there was an opportunity for these actors to work a lot because of the war. And we were making costume films, and we were making historical dramas, and we were making war films. And all of these called for actors of this caliber. My father made 70 films in his career, of which I think 40-some were in Hollywood.
I'm going to hold up this page, and your father is in that furthest corner, and... how old was he there?
I would guess he was probably in his early 30s. And he was at that point appearing in plays in London at that point.
Yeah. Yeah. And I must say, a lot of this book, I kept saying, where did he do the research? Who helped him get all of these pictures?
Well, I was very lucky. I had tremendous help on a number of levels. I actually spent a lot of time at the University of Southern California Library, because they maintain the Universal Pictures production logs and all of that. So that gave me the opportunity to find out how much people were paid and how long it took to make the film. And then I also was at the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, where they had the correspondence for Universal at that time. But then I had this fabulous guy whose name is Scott Gollinghouse, who was an amateur genealogist. And he had done this, I guess, out of as a hobby. And a fellow author and I, Tom Weaver, who has interviewed me in a couple of his books, were good friends, and I mentioned to him one day what I was planning to do, but I said, I'm a little concerned how I'm going to get all the information, and he said, I've got a guy that I think might be of help to you. And he put us in touch. Scott lives in New Orleans, and thank heavens for the internet, because we were able to communicate. Yeah. And he was very helpful in giving me the background on, like, their birth material and perhaps some of their travel arrangements and things like that. And then we were able to get a lot of newspaper clippings, which also were interviews with these people. And then the photographs were by a number of different people were able to give me photographs. And through the magic of Photoshop, I was able to go in and find close-ups, because there weren't very many individual photographs of a lot of these actors. So I was able to create those. And it was my point that I wanted this book to identify all of these actors and actresses that we had seen in these films, but didn't know who they were and anything about them. So that was really what I set out to do in the book.
I have to hold up one more picture of, the woman.
You should turn the page and show her in life, too. But
A little more.
This was one of the actresses, Lillian Benson, and a wonderful, wonderful actress who worked in many, many years in television. If you go back one page, you'll find a picture of her.
But his House of Fear, the way you have all of these photographs from the boards. Yeah.
Yeah, that was one of the collectors that I had that was able to give me those. And as I say, I was really pleased with the fact that I was able to get an individual photograph of each actor or actress in the film, so that everybody could see what they looked like and then read about them and say, oh yeah, I remember them. Yes. I've seen them on television 100 times, because many of them had made over 100 films each.
Michael, I have to tell our friends too that you have written, 6 to 10 films for Elvis Presley.
Yeah, I did 6 pictures. I was like a contributing writer on 4 of them, which meant that I didn't get screen credit, but I was on the picture. On 2 of them, I actually wrote the screenplays. Live a Little, Love a Little, and Stay Away Joe.
Yeah. What was he like to work with?
I liked him very much. He was very shy. When I first met him, I thought he was kind of standoffish, but I realized it was just that he was shy. And he had a great sense of humor, and he was a great fan of movies, and he knew a lot about films. And we would discuss films a lot in between shots. And one day I remember we were doing Live a Little, Love a Little, and he came in and he kind of did this and signaled me to come into another part of the set that we weren't lighting. And it was a bedroom set, and I remember he laid out on the bed about 3 or 4 photographs of a baby, and of course it was Lisa Marie, and he said to me, that's my baby. He was very proud of
her. Did he have opinions on how he wanted the script to look, to how he wanted to be portrayed?
He did, but he didn't express them. He allowed Colonel Parker to kind of control his career. It was unfortunate. Norman and I worked for most of those films with a marvelous director by the name of Norman Torog, who actually directed the first film that I did at Warner Brothers after I was moved up. And we became friends and associates, and I ended up doing about 9 pictures with Norman. At some point, we had a conversation about how obviously Elvis's career was not moving in the right direction because of the types of films that he was making. And we kind of sat down and threw some ideas together, and I wrote up a couple of treatments. And I remember one that we liked very much, non-musical, although they could have put a song in at the main title and stuff like that. But we felt that maybe the secret was to give him a dramatic role. And I knew that he could do it. I had seen King Creole, which was one of his first films, and he was marvelous in that, very dramatic role. So we took it to Elvis one day, and he said, I don't look at scripts, or don't give it to the colonel and see what he has to say. We gave it to the colonel, and the colonel's answer was, I don't read material. Give me $1 million and you can shoot the phone book, as far as I'm concerned. So that was kind of the attitude. It was an unfortunate thing.
Yeah.
I always blamed the colonel more than anybody for the fact that Elvis's career in films went downhill. Of course, he went on from there to be very, very successful as a concert artist.
Yeah. Michael, who gave you your break?
Who gave me my break? I guess in a way it was Jack Warner in that scene, story that I told you
about. But you still have to get somebody who brought you into the studio.
Well, there was a very dear friend of my father's by the name of Herb Meadow, who was a screenwriter. And Herb, when I was 12, 12 or 13 years old, I had my first idea that I wanted to be a writer, and I wrote an adaptation of a book, which was incidentally written by Frank Gruber, who was one of the authors of one of the screenplays in the Sherlock Holmes series. And of course, all I did was read the book, and then I sat down and I had no idea what a format of a screenplay was like. And in pencil, in a school notebook, I wrote this screenplay out, and I had the audacity to give it to Herb and ask him to read it. And the dear man read it, not only read it, but gave me notes on it. And I will never forget that. And through the years, Herb was tremendously helpful as I built my career as a writer.
Michael, fascinating talking to you. I love the book because of the histories in it and the work you did. And
thank you.
Will you autograph my book?
I will.
And
great
if you'd
pleasure.
Like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. Watch some of the other shows we've done by linking into YouTube or Claremont Graduate University. But support your local library. Whatever you do, it's our most important institution in America, and never more so than right now. And so, as I say, support it, and we'll see you next time. Thank you so much, Michael.
Thank you. I enjoyed this very much.
Thank you.